Ronald Erwin McNair was born on October 21, 1950, in Lake City, South Carolina. The second of three boys born to Carl, a mechanic, and Pearl, a teacher, McNair displayed an early aptitude for technical matters, earning the nickname Gizmo. McNair's interest in space was piqued by the launch of the Russian satellite Sputnik in 1957 and boosted by the appearance of Star Trek on TV years later, its multi-ethnic cast pushing the boundaries of what was possible for a small-town African-American boy.
When he was 9 years old, Ron, without my parents or myself knowing his whereabouts, decided to take a mile walk from our home down to the library, which was, of course, public library, but not so public for black folks when you're talking about 1959. So as he was walking in there, all these folks were staring at him because they were white folk only, and they were looking at him and said, you know, who's this Negro? So he politely positioned himself in line to check out his books. Well, this old librarian, she says, this library is not for coloreds. He said, well, I would like to check out these books. She says, young man, if you don't leave this library right now, I'm going to call the police. So he just propped himself up on the counter and sat there and said, I'll wait. So she called the police and subsequently called my mother. Police came down, two burly guys come in and say, well, where's the disturbance? And she pointed to the little nine-year-old boy sitting up on the counter. He says, man, what's the problem? So my mother, in the meanwhile, she was called. She comes down there praying the whole way there. Lord Jesus, please don't let them put my child in jail. And my mother asked the librarian, what's the problem? Well, he wanted to check out the books. And you know your son shouldn't be down here. And the police officer said, you know, why don't you just give the kid the books? And my mother said, he'll take good care of them. And reluctantly, the librarian gave Ron the books. And my mother said, what did you say? He said, thank you, ma'am. Later on, as youngsters, a show came on TV called Star Trek. Now, Star Trek showed the future where there were black folk and white folk working together. Right. And I looked at it as science fiction, because that wasn't going to happen, really. But Ronald saw it as science possibility. Mm-hmm. You know, he came up during a time when there was Neil Armstrong and all of those guys. So how was a colored boy from South Carolina wearing glasses, never flew a plane, how was he going to become an astronaut? But Ron was the one who didn't accept societal norms as being his norm. I mean, that was for other people. And he got to be aboard his own Starship Enterprise.
While working as a staff physicist at Hughes Research Laboratories, McNair learned that NASA was looking for scientists to join the shuttle program. Of the 11,000 applicants, McNair was one of the 35 selected in January 1978, and he completed his training and evaluation period the following August. About 5 months after UNS Bruford became the first African American in space, McNair became the second with the launch of the STS-41B mission of the Space Shuttle Challenger on February 3, 1984. A mission specialist, McNair operated Challenger's robotic arm to help astronaut Bruce McCandless conduct his historic untethered spacewalk. McNair logged 101 90 hours in space as Challenger orbited Earth 122 times before returning to Kennedy Space Center on February 11. In early 1985, McNair was tapped for the STS-51L mission of the Space Shuttle Challenger, an undertaking that would draw media attention for its selection of teacher Krista McAuliffe as a civilian payload specialist. McNair was tasked with controlling Challenger's robotic arm to release and retrieve a satellite to observe Halley's Comet. After multiple delays, Challenger launched from Cape Canaveral, Florida shortly before noon on January 28, 1986. 73 seconds later on live television, the shuttle suddenly exploded at around 46,000 feet, killing all seven crew members. McNair was just 35 years old. McNair's legacy endures through the various educational initiatives and programs that bear his name. Founded in 1996, the Dr. Ronald E. McNair Educational Science Literacy Foundation, DREM, encourages students from kindergarten through college in areas of STEM learning. Additionally, the U.S. Department of Education's Ronald E. McNair Postbaccalaureate Achievement Program provides grants to promising students from disadvantaged backgrounds. McNair's accomplishments also influenced the following.